Good evening. The U.S. Central Bank, the Federal Reserve, cut interest rates by 0.5% tonight, the first cut in 4 years. It's been seen as a signal the Fed wants to revive the housing market and head off a possible recession. Meanwhile, here, the nightmare on the high street seems to be over, at least for now. Yesterday's guarantees from the government have calmed Northern Rock investors and cheered up the stock market. We'll hear from the bank regulators in a moment and from economic commentators on both sides of the Atlantic. First, here's our economics editor, Stephanie Flanders.
Today, the storm over Northern Rock seemed to be abating. Queues were shorter and sweeter, and the share price was up. Attention then turned to the ripple effects for other banks, for the economy, and for the government.
This is a set of financial problems that have happened in America, spread to Germany and Europe, and now we're seeing some instances of that in Northern Rock in the United Kingdom. But we are an economy that has taken the measures that have been necessary to keep a stable economy, so inflation is coming down, and at the same time we've put in place regulatory measures that make sure that when incidents like this happen, they are properly dealt with.
There are plenty of questions being raised in the city about the way this crisis has been handled. But the more pressing question this morning was, would yesterday's extraordinary announcement stop the rot? Well, for now at least, the answer seems to be yes. All the banks that got hammered in the markets yesterday, today saw their shares go back up. One of the big US investment banks, Lehman Brothers, announced its third quarter results this morning. They hadn't been hit as hard as some had feared, but there could be plenty more bad news to come.
Because regulators have focused so much on trying to rid bank balance sheets of too much risk, the banks have really shifted this risk to other people. And the other people tend to be hedge funds or other institutions that don't really have the ability to hang on to risk for a very long period of time. And as a result, the longer this period of risk and uncertainty and high risk premiums last, the more these institutions are going to have to try and dump these assets on the marketplace. And that's why this predicament can roll on for quite some time.
We don't know the full extent of the damage to our financial system, but the damage to the credibility of our authorities, that's pretty clear. Some say the problem stems from Gordon Brown's decision to take responsibility for financial regulation away from the Bank of England when he made it independent in 97. Then Governor Eddie George was so against the change, he nearly resigned.
I think what is now clear is that it's very dangerous to separate banking regulation from the role of lender of last resort to the banks. The banking regulators, I don't think, can regulate properly unless they appreciate that they're the ones who are going to be left holding the baby. What we've effectively seen is a business model that, with 2020 hindsight, hasn't worked. And that's been under the regulation of the FSA. But the people who then had to deal with the problem have been the Bank of England.
Officials do think there are lessons to be learned, but they're focused on formally extending deposit insurance to prevent the kind of bank-run mentality you saw with Northern Rock. Some say that's not so much locking the stable door as propping it open.
We're partly in this mess because our monetary policy was probably quite easy, credit was cheap, and our regulatory oversight was not as strong as it should have been. It doesn't seem to me that the right thing then to do in a crisis is respond by making credit cheap and to insure depositors and therefore relax some of the regulatory oversight because depositors are now insured.
Of course, the biggest unanswered question is what the fallout from the markets will be for all of us. As far as the real economy is concerned, we are already seeing some effects.
It does look as if we're even seeing the start of a process of fewer transactions, fewer deals, fewer private equity financed deals, and I suspect we'll also see fewer mortgages advanced.
The biggest player in all this, the Federal Reserve Chairman, tried to take charge today with a hefty 0.5 percentage point cut in interest rates. The stock market cheered, but some thought it might be storing up trouble for the future.
Well, I believe the Fed has cut the Fed funds rate aggressively in an attempt to mitigate the potential negative impact on the economy from the instability in the financial markets. But I think over the longer term, there are some potentially negative impacts on inflation, and I think that some markets are, such as the currency markets and the gold markets, are suggesting that the inflationary impact of this move might be more negative.
The Fed had a difficult balance to strike tonight between reacting too little and too much. The cut produced a 2.5% rise in the Dow, but some will say it also paved the way for another boom and bust. The Treasury faces the same challenge in rewriting the rulebook after Northern Rock. So will the Monetary Policy Committee when it sets our rates next month.
We asked Northern Rock to take part in tonight's programme, but again, they declined. I was joined by Sir Callum McCarthy, the chairman of the regulating agency, the Financial Services Authority. I asked him when he realised Northern Rock was in trouble, because some critics claim the FSA was far too slow to act.
No, I think that we have, as we do with all major banks and financial institutions, been monitoring their position quite carefully. We intensified our monitoring at the beginning of August for all institutions when it became clear that world markets were turbulent. And we've treated Northern Rock as we have treated other people.
Why did you describe those who were worried about losing their savings, despite the guarantees, as behaving irrationally?
I was very careful not to describe people as irrational. What I am pointing out is that, unlike the previous position, the statement that the Chancellor made yesterday evening changes the position completely.
But you did describe on the BBC it would now be irrational to worry about your deposit following the guarantee. And I'm just suggesting to you that the savers behave perfectly rationally, given that they clearly did not trust the system.
I'm pointing out that the position changed emphatically and dramatically with the clear guarantee given by the Chancellor yesterday evening. And after that, there is no need for anybody to queue, and I would point out that people have behaved perfectly sensibly in the light once they understood the reality of that guarantee from the Chancellor.
And just to be absolutely clear on this, given what the Chancellor has said today, this applies to other banks that might get into difficulty, which means that we now have a system where it's not just everything of the first £2,000 and then a proportion, 90% up to £35,000. Every penny of every depositor in every major bank is now guaranteed by the government.
No, I don't think it is quite that, because the Chancellor made it very clear that he was dealing in comparable circumstances with comparable banks. And the importance of Northern Rock was that if Northern Rock had failed, there was the danger of contagion to other parts of the financial system and other parts of the economy. And it has always been accepted that there would be circumstances, there could be circumstances, in which a run on a bank should be prevented, not for the purpose of saving that bank, but because of the wider impact.
I think some people might be still confused. I certainly am. What do you mean by it only applies to comparable banks?
Because there are some banks which will have systemic importance, and there might be other financial institutions with non-systemic importance. But it is a judgment that will be made, and the Chancellor will make it, and make it quite clearly.
We've heard some criticism today to going right back to the very start of the FSA in 1997, that frankly you shouldn't exist at all, that the regulation should be done by the Bank of England, because they're the people who have to bail out the banks anyway.
This has been long debated. I can explain to you why both the Bank of England and the FSA believe that there are advantages in the clarity of responsibility that lies between the bank as a bank, the FSA as a regulator, the position of the Treasury. Those are responsibilities that are very clearly defined in a memorandum of understanding.
And I'm just wondering what else might change in the future as a result of what we've gone through in the past month or so. For example, there are those who say that the American model of what the FDIC does, being able to in effect step in, pay off depositors very quickly, that is a better model than we have here.
I think there are some very interesting issues for us to work our way through in relation to the compensation scheme that we have. One of the things that is quite clear is that the worries of the understandable worries of the customers of Northern Rock were in part due to that, the difference between compensation schemes. In part, they were due to a series of logistical problems.
Do you worry that we could see the same thing happening again tomorrow or the next day or next week?
I don't believe that we should or will see the same thing happening tomorrow or next week. I am concerned that there is a very serious global set of circumstances which we are all going to, in each country, deal with. But I do take some comfort from the fact that we have an extraordinarily soundly based British banking system. British banks are very well capitalized. They're coming off 5 or more years of high profits. They are in a good position to withstand the pressures which I think banks around the world are going to be subject to.
So, Callum, thank you very much.
Not at all.
Well, before we get to the wider economy, let's have a look at what all this activity has done to the markets. The FTSE 100 share index closed up 100 points. In New York, the Dow Jones closed up more than 300 points after the Fed's reduction of interest rates. Against the euro, the pound was up. Against the dollar, the pound was also up. Stephanie Flanders is here, and so is Richard Lambert, now of the CBI, formerly of the Bank of England's Monetary Policy Committee. We're also joined from Washington by the economic commentator, Erwin Stelzer, of the Hudson Institute. Mr. Stelzer, good evening to you. What do you make of what the Fed did today?
Well, I think that Chairman Bernanke had to walk between, I would say, a Northern Rock and a hard place. He had to both satisfy the expectations of the market, not dash them completely. He had to, at the same time, try to avoid this so-called moral hazard, rewarding improvident lenders and borrowers. And probably came out with the right combination, adding a dash of liquidity by lowering the discount rate as well. He also, you know, there was some pressure on him to produce a unanimous vote on the committee. And I suspect if he were king, if he didn't have a committee, he would not want to have cut the discount rate quite as much as he did. But in all the circumstances, I think he succeeded and at the same time warned people that he hadn't forgotten about inflation, so they better not expect him to keep cutting rates automatically. He would have to look at circumstances as they develop. All in all, a tough decision and quite a reasonable one.
Richard Lambert, tough, reasonable, and perhaps with implications for what Bank of England will do next month.
Well, a very abrupt change of direction by the Fed in the last month, and some risks on the inflation side as a result of all that, I think. I think we're in a slightly different place here in the UK. The economy here is still strong, and there's no inflation is, you know, there are still inflationary risks in the system. I think that if it were other circumstances, if there weren't all this stuff bubbling along in the financial markets, people would not be looking for an interest rate cut in the near future.
Is there some risk to the Fed's credibility, Stephanie?
Well, I think if there's a perception that you put the markets first before and increased fears of inflation, that will hurt credibility. And it was interesting to see the reaction in the markets as we saw the stock market cheered and short-term interest rates fell, but actually long-term interest rates and gold all went up because there was perceived to be an increased inflation fear. And more generally, he's given this perception the last month that he's allowed the perception to gain root, that he had promised the markets a rate cut. He had himself pictured with senior legislators and Congress. You know, these are things that have possibly hurt his credibility because he seemed to be sort of boosting the market too much.
Well, just to pick that up, Erwin Stelzer, I mean, when we've heard from the Tories talking about the decade of debt in Britain, we've heard other people say the core of this problem is easy money and bad lending of various sorts. How does it help things to reduce interest rates and, in the case of Northern Rock, to appear to be bailing out a bank which took some wrong decisions?
Well, as I said before, I think if he had his own way, the chairman would not have cut by 50 basis points. But he had to, and I think he did badly manage the expectations of the market, and he let it just run away with the notion that he was going to do this, and if he didn't, all hell would have broken loose. On the other hand, I think he retrieved a little by reminding people that the economy was in relatively good shape, that inflation still troubled him, don't look for me to do this again unless the situation deteriorates more. So I don't think it was a perfect decision. I think it was an understandable decision.
Just on that, Richard Lambert, on that point about if the core of the problem is indeed easy money and bad lending, what do you make of how this will be interpreted over the longer term?
Well, you see, I don't agree with the idea that you were suggesting at the beginning that this is a credit crunch. It's not about credit shortages. It's not about a solvency crisis. This is a crisis of trust and confidence, and that's why it's been so difficult to draw a red line under it, and that's why the Chancellor last night had to take extreme steps, as you described, extreme steps to say, you know, everybody's guaranteed. So the great question is, will this do the trick here in the UK? I think the signs are that it will do the trick, and we'll look back on it as an episode from which lessons need to be learned, but it's not going to have a substantial impact on the economy going forward.
Well, because tell us a bit about what the CBI was suggesting today. I mean, it was far from gloomy, although you...
Yeah, I mean, it looks pretty much as though the UK economy this year will grow at about 3%, which is a bit above its long-term trend. It was going to slow down next year anyway. We've had 5 bank rate increases. That was bound to put the brakes on a bit, and the world's slowing down a bit. And now it's likely to slow down a bit more, but we still expect growth next year of 2% plus. There are bigger risks than there were in the system, obviously, but the way to bet is that we'll muddle through.
We'll muddle through, and the confidence has been restored largely. The Northern Rock problem is over.
Well, I mean, we obviously hope that's the case. I guess the only issue would be, certainly when you talk to people in the markets, there is a worry about the housing market. I mean, we are, like the US was a year and a half ago, a very indebted country that's very dependent on the housing market for consumer confidence and for a lot of the growth that we've seen. And, you know, one direct consequence of the banks having to take all these losses onto their balance sheets, all of these strange vehicles, is if they do that, they will have less room to lend in the next year or so. And, you know, that could end up having an effect. It will hit borrowing conditions for people with mortgages.
Yeah, it would start. So on that point, I mean, we heard Alan Greenspan over here this week saying Britain is more exposed than we are in the sense that you have a good deal more adjustable rate mortgages. I mean, do you foresee on that narrow issue of the British housing market, which is very, very important to us, some real problems ahead?
Well, you do have problems ahead. We have problems ahead. I don't think the problems are insurmountable. I think Sir Callum, as usual, had it right. The banks are well capitalized. They've had 5 years of very good earnings. I think that they will, because they've had to take some of this stuff on their balance sheet, be able to lend less. And I think the real problem in America is going to be that after 4% growth, 2% doesn't feel quite so good. But I don't see any calamity here, and I don't see any calamity in Britain, unless, of course, foolish things happen, like taxes go up when the economy is slowing or something like that. You might have 3% growth, you might have 2%, but these jiggles in the upward movement of your economy and my economy are to be expected, and I think Alan Greenspan made clear that in market economies, these things happen. Look how quickly America recovered from 9/11. I mean, we're way, way ahead of where we were then. That was a much bigger calamity than what's going on now in financial markets.
That is a fair point, isn't it? It was a much bigger calamity. But do you still have a sense that this was a watershed moment because of what has happened over the past 4 or 5 years?
We have never seen anything like this in our lives. I've seen loads and loads of ups and downs. I've never seen anything like this. Where confidence drained out of the system, and it looked for just a brief hour or two yesterday afternoon that there was something bad, seriously bad, might happen. Now, there's a red line under that, that's checked. And I think that if we're right about the forward look for the economy, if Stephanie obviously rightly puts a question mark over the housing sector, but if we're right, and Irwin is right, that, you know, there's a fair measure of stability, I think we'll look back on this as an exceptional moment, but not one that's changed the shape of history.
But it also might change the shape of bank regulation in Britain, might it?
I think that the deposit guarantee system will have to be looked at. That's clear. I think that, you know, the idea of putting regulation under the Bank of England is completely nuts and for the birds. The FSA is the place to keep that stuff done, and I'm sure the bank doesn't want it back.
Thanks very much. Now, here's a mystery story. Israel bombed something in Syria around 12 days ago. We don't know what and we don't know why. There's a news blackout in Israel and in Syria. We've heard rumors of everything from a nuclear facility established by North Korea to some other possibilities, including links to Hezbollah and Iran. Now, diplomatic editor Mark Urban now reports on what we know and what we don't.
It was Syrian television that first broke news that Israeli aircraft had flown across the country.